My name is Katriel Schory, and I have 3 more days as the executive director of the Israel Film Fund, completing almost 21 years as the head of the Israel Film Fund. During these years, I authorized the production of almost 300 full-length narrative feature films, primarily aimed for the cinema, signed over 200 million euros of taxpayers' money, which went into these movies. And I'll share with you a little bit. I'll just say also a couple of words about myself. After a very long military service in the elite combat special forces of the Israeli military, I applied for the NYU, and for some reason they accepted me. So I went to America. It was in 1969. As you see, I'm old. And I belong to the famous generation of sex, drugs, and rock and roll. And I spent some wild 4 years in New York studying films. And until today, it's not clear why in early 1973, I returned to Israel. For 5 years, I did everything that one can do on a set, maybe 280, 290 days out of every year out on location, what the Americans will call a set animal. And after 5 years, I felt that I was ready to open my own production company, which I did. And I produced endless amount of hours and stuff and so on for TV, movies, production services, you name it. I was involved in what is considered probably the most successful one of the most successful Israeli feature films of all times. We went all the way to the final five and the Oscars, red carpet, this and that. And we sold almost 1 million tickets in Israel, which was quite an achievement. 4 years later, I produced what is considered probably the worst disaster ever in the history of Israeli cinema, where I lost everything I ever had and I had to start all over again. So I was there, and I'll try and share with you a little of what I've learned throughout the years. In these 300 films, which I greenlighted, about 80 or 75, 80 were international co-productions. The fund is an NGO, it's not a government organization, it's fully financed by taxpayers' money, but the whole idea was to keep the politicians as far away as possible. And this allowed us to be really independent and really, really raise and can really insist on our prime objective, at least the way I saw it, to keep and safeguard the complete creative freedom of the Israeli filmmakers and the Israel film industry, which of course brought me and my team into tremendous friction and a lot of troubles with the government, but we insisted on it, because we thought that without this, there's no point in having a fund and we cannot make the films we would like to make. So this very much in a very quick, the way I will, my little intro to you. And then actually to get to the point. First of all, I would say there are two elements which really all the time guided me. One is, as I say, the complete creative freedom, which for me, it's like the prime objective and has been all these years. And the second thing is also to remember ourselves as people and as human beings. You know, we all decided to hook our life to a very influential art form. It's probably the most influential art form of our times. And I think that because of that, we bear a tremendous responsibility. So I'm not, you see, I'm old and not that naive to think that a film will change the life completely of someone. But you never know. And you heard earlier this morning, things can happen, especially with kids and so on. And therefore, we have a tremendous responsibility as filmmakers, as film people, never to forget our values as human beings and never to forget our morals and always remember where do we draw the line in terms of being really truthful to ourselves and not abuse the power that was given to us in our hands. And this is something which all the time guided me because you know very well like me, that there's never-ending possibilities of manipulation like in any other art form, and it's perfectly okay by the mere fact that you decide on an angle or on a lens, you already made a point and there is a certain level of manipulation. This is perfectly okay. The question is, where do we draw the line? Where do we live with ourselves in peace? And where do we not abuse the power which was given to us in the most popular and the most influential art form? And especially it goes when we talk also about kids and so on. So I was asked to become the head of the fund actually by the industry at the lowest point, at the worst moment in the history of Israeli cinema, which was 1998, in which we completely lost our audiences. And in that year, the total number of admissions to all the Israeli feature films released in the cinema that year was 36,000 out of 10 million. We were basically wiped out, finished, 0.3%. And the politicians told us it was nice knowing you, goodbye, there's no point in making films in Israel, full stop. And we had to actually restart all over again, and we had to get to see how do we regain again the confidence, the will of the Israeli audiences to go back. And also we had in many ways to reinvent ourselves. But the main thing that I thought when I was asked to, I said to the industry, I will do it, we do it all together. We put our differences aside, producers, directors, this, that, and we go together and we try to save ourselves. And the first thing that I decided to do was really to install again the self-confidence, the self-image, the trust in ourselves as filmmakers, which we lost throughout the years because we didn't get the audience anymore. We disappeared from the world, festivals, etc. And we had to, first of all, to install in ourselves the confidence that we can still make films and we can still make films which will bring people to the cinemas. And I did it by really remembering and reminding all of us that we had some successes in the past, that there was a base for Israeli cinema and we should not forget it. So it was a process that we had to go through. The second thing is that we decided completely to change the way we read, the way we select. We decided to open up our stories, to open up the fund to stories coming from all walks of life and not this type of navel-gazing type movies of the Tel Aviv community, but really having films of coming from all over. And especially in a crazy country that I come from, which is so turbulent and multicultural and people coming from 70 countries and a country which in many ways is the headache of the world. And you know, what do you do with all the stories and how do you manage in this place? But there was a tremendous energy and a tremendous creative energy and a real turbulence. And what you actually see and what we realized that the Israeli cinema is extremely low on adaptations. And most of the stories really come from the personal experience that we all have. If you go back, and there are people who know very well the Israeli cinema, you'll see that adaptations is not really our story. And the same goes also for films for children. So first of all, we changed completely the way we read, the way we select. We opened up the fund to stories coming from all over, from the regions, from different places, from different communities, and so on and so on and so on, to get a real diversity of projects coming in. And then this was one part of the whole thing, because we had to recreate a new type of cinema, if you like, or a different type of cinema than what we have had before. All this super art house, this old Weltschmerz coming from Tel Aviv, all these very depressed people, and we had to look and do a complete different understanding of the kind of stories which we wanted. And then we had to decide how do we go out and convince the people to come and see again a movie. And basically, I think that I went for the most simplistic, most primitive, if you like, brand, like a slogan saying, give us one more chance. We know that you had bad experiences. We know that you didn't like the films. We know that you turned your back on our films. Things are changing. Give us one more chance. The other element that we understood, and I think it applies, and also it comes out also from today's sessions and so on, is that we cannot wait. And we were not able to wait for the people to come to the cinema to watch the movies. We had to reach out. We had to reach out all the time. And I made a very tough decision with the agreement of my board that instead of putting money in bringing the people to the cinema, which is normally the way we should do it, we will put money in taking the films to the people, because they are actually paying for the films. It's taxpayers' money. They don't want to see it in the cinemas. They don't want to come. We will go to them. And it was a very long process, which ended up with hundreds and hundreds of initiatives day by day, minute by minute, reaching out with our films to all the villages, to the towns, to wherever you want, to factories, to big institutions, small institutions, whatever you want. And then I had to do, to make a decision, which is not a very nice one, but there was no choice, and start the motion by looking on captive audiences and say, well, let's start at least with captive audience, audiences which are giving an order to go and see a movie, an Israeli movie. So where do we find them? We find them in schools. We find them in some institutions. We find them in the military, in police, I don't know, all kinds of places. We say, now you have to go and see a movie. So this doesn't sound very nice, but we had no choice. My biggest fight was with the Israeli airline, because they kicked me out of the office saying all the Israeli films stink. And I said, you are the national carrier. You should give a chance at least for someone to see an Israeli movie in the airline. They kicked me out. I went to the Minister of Transportation. I had no choice. So at the end, they started putting films in the airline. Now, of course, they want all of that. So basically, what I'm trying to tell you is that we had to turn every stone in order to reinvent our audiences and recreate our audiences. And when it comes to schools, there was already an infrastructure, because we have in the country something which is called a basket, in which the parents and the schools and the town and the Ministry of Education, they put a bit of money for art and culture activities throughout the year for the school kids. And this committee in each school decides what to invite. So they used to invite, of course, theater, music, dance, this and that, but they never had in mind to invite an Israeli movie. So we had to convince them. So finally we managed to do it, and then the school started ordering 3-4 screenings of 3-4 movies a year in each school. Slowly, slowly, it became a huge thing. And now we are talking about hundreds of screenings in the school system in the country. And this is in addition to the fact that kids are exposed, like 70,000, 80,000, 90,000 kids. And I made it very clear, we will not take them to the cinemas. They will see it in the school. Not the best quality, not the best screening quality, but at least they will watch an Israeli film. But all the screenings were always accompanied with the director, producer, the actor, as an event. And also, because I know that the teachers are usually lazy people, we created for them a kit about the film that is going to be screened in the school, which was really a bunch of papers, and which they could prepare the kids before they're going to see the movie, so that they will not just go and see a movie without some preparation in a lecture by the teacher. So the teacher received from us a kit, papers, everything, so that they can be prepared for that. And what has happened is that this has become now a secondary market, an auxiliary market, whichever you want to call it, because it's money. Because every screening, I made it the point that the producer will get a screening fee of about 200 euros for each screening, and the director or the writer, whoever comes to speak, will get about 150 euros for speaking. So now there are a few directors in Israel that really were able to carry on with their life 1, 2, 3 years only from the money they made going from one school to the other. But this has become like a market, or an additional market for the films. Basically, what I'm trying to tell you is, of course, we would like to have all of them come and see the films in the cinemas. Of course, this is our wish, and this is what we would like. But we live in a reality, we live in a situation that we have to think on alternative platforms and additional platforms. And one of them, in our case, is the school. And the other way, and I can give you some more examples. I don't know how much time, I still have a bit of time. But, for example, we made a deal with most of the cultural centers in the country, because now the DCP is not so expensive as it used to be, and many of them are installed. I mean, many of the cultural centers, you have the DCP in a deal which we made with the lottery, and they bought and installed all those DCPs in the cultural centers in the countries, because the cultural centers primarily are not built as cinemas. But still, you can use them. So now we have in the about 45, 50 cultural centers in the country, a whole network which is called season tickets, in which the people in these towns can buy a season ticket for 6 new Israeli feature films every year. And of course, in a lower price. Of course, they don't know which the films will be, because we are not the producers, so we don't know which film will be ready. But we can guarantee 6 new films every year on a lower price. And now in many of these towns, we have 300, 400, 250 people who buy this annual the subscription fee, and they have this season ticket for 6 new Israeli feature films. But the whole idea is that all these people in all these towns are seeing the films in previous screenings before the big premiere in the big cities. So they feel a little privileged. They feel that they see it before everybody else. But we, as a fund, decided and we created the software and also a whole thing of papers and so on, and we use these screenings as focus groups in which we learn, because different towns have different social levels and so on and so on. So you can create from all of this a kind of a strategy how to prepare yourself for the release of the film. In addition, we had also a situation which we have a situation that maybe is good for us, because we are a small country and it is possible. And you know, we are not bound by anything, because as you know, we are not in Creative Europe, we are not in Eurimage, we are not with nowhere. We are what we are. So we had to look after ourselves, so we are not bound by anything. So we are running a kind of a partisan guerrilla type fund and so on. And we decided on different ways that we want to do. And because the distributors in Israel are also the cinema owners, like in many of the small countries, we understood, they said, we are ready to release your film and distribute your film, but we are not ready to take a €1 risk. So I said, why should I give you 20-25% distribution fee if you are not ready to take one penny risk with me on the P&A? So we decided in the fund, because we as a fund decided to divert money once to support the P&A, the distribution, marketing, and release of every film. So everyone who receives from us money for production receives an additional amount on a separate contract for the marketing, distribution, and release, up to 40-45,000 euros. This is one thing. And then, I told them, if you are not ready to take any risk, we don't need you. We don't need you. So what has happened now, that more than 50% of all the Israeli feature films are distributed by the producers. And basically, it's what we call a four-wall deal. It's between the producer directly to the cinema owner. The cinema owner will give you his four walls, and do what you want. But in this way, because the producer in that case becomes also a distributor, he is entitled to the 25% distribution fee, which we all know it's part of the first money coming in. So at the moment, looking back at almost 20 years, I think that it really balanced out. More than half of the film are being still distributed by the producers, and they're doing a very good job. And of course, you can argue back that distribution is a skill and the producers are not distributors. So what has happened? That a new job surfaced in the country. We have 4 or 5 people that all they do in life, they are what we call distribution managers. So the same as a producer will hire a production manager or a line producer, he hires a distribution manager. Somebody who really knows booking, this, that, cinema, and so on, but he reports to the producer. And the producer and the producing team control the faith and the destiny of their films. And with films for children, it's even more so, because I don't know how many are ready to take the risk on film for kids. And in a small country the way we are, it's perfectly okay. But in addition to this money that goes into the particular productions, we decided to divert a certain amount of money to all these umbrella initiatives which I mentioned a minute before. In addition, I don't know if you know, but the Ministry of Education, somebody who I know for many years, she was a very strong woman, still is, she convinced the Ministry of Education to create a situation in which the high school kids in the last 3 years, 10, 11, 12, can choose to do as one of their matriculation tests or one of their matriculation subjects, film and communication. Film and communication, 3 years, 10, 11, 12. And it really started small, and now we have 220 high schools in the country in which kids can, those high school kids can decide to go for the last 3 years of high school, pick as one of the subjects, really film and communication, which means that in 220 schools, there is a studio, there are cameras, there are lights, there is sound, and there is everything. And these 3 years, it's a very precise and a really tough curriculum for these kids. It's not that simple. They are very carefully selected, but they go for these 3 years, and it's twofold. One is, of course, a lot about the history and this and that, and the film language, and the film grammar, and this and that. But the other one is also making a film, making a short film, making a film, which is part of the final exams. And I initiated a kind of a competition, if you like, a little festival between all these schools. And we gather every year like 2,000 kids of all those departments for 3 days, and we just screen the final 20 or the final 15 or 20 of this film, which are all produced in these schools. And this has been working. So when you talk about 220 schools, even if you have 10, 15 kids in each school, it's a number. And then the best of them, what happens is that they have to go to military service. And military service is 3 years. And in the Israeli military, every unit has its own film unit, the Navy, the Air Force, the intelligence, this and that. So now these kids, the better ones, are being picked up by the military to be in these film units. So now they have another 3 years of making films as soldiers. So it's another 3 years. So there are about 150 of them spread in all these military units, about 200. So this is another 3 years of just doing training films, whatever. And then I meet them in the Tel Aviv University Film Department for another 4 years. So, but basically what I'm trying to tell you is that the whole thing is like all the time from all around, and it really works, because basically what it created also is an awareness, a will, a curiosity, and a tremendous interest in this particular art form, which for many years was a stepchild in the Israeli culture, and now it's not anymore, and we are a legitimate child in the Israeli culture. In addition, in the Jerusalem Film Festival, I initiated together with the festival, for example, some years ago, an initiative which is called IMUR, in which we took a bunch of Palestinian kids from East Jerusalem and a bunch of Israeli kids from the Jewish part of Jerusalem or the Israeli part of Jerusalem. We checked them, we did interviews. They were kids of 15 years old. And in the summer vacation, we created a crash course of 6 weeks in which those kids were split into groups of 5, 6, and these kids basically got a 1 week of understanding storytelling and so on. Of course, it's very fast, but still 1 week of storytelling and ideas and this and that and sources of stories and everything. And then another week in which they got their hands on equipment and what to do with equipment and this and that and so on, all guided by the top film professionals of the country. And then basically on the third week, we handed over to them the equipment. And we handed over to them the equipment to go and shoot their small films in their own neighborhoods, in the Palestinian side and the Israeli side, but they work together. And this is why we call this initiative IMUR. And it was all about identity and so on. It lasted 9 years. And because we got the support from some donors and so on. And during these 9 years, we ended up with a whole bunch of short films by these 15-year-old kids. Now I see them 15 years, 20 years, 10 years after, and some of them decided to make it their living, if you like. So basically, we see that there are a lot of possibilities and options to really connect and get together and do things together and use the film language as an identity, as expressing the place you come from, as really using this particular language, which is the language of our times. And basically, I would say that it's very much in our hands how proactive we want to be, how many flags we want to raise, and how much energy do we want to put into it. For me, when it comes to content and when it comes to stories, I think, honestly, looking a little bit from the side, that Europe is very privileged because you have here money for development. And unlike those frightened, coward executives of Hollywood who will only do remakes because they don't dare to take a real chance on a real story, in Europe, you can still dare. We can still dare. We can really take chances. We can take risks. We can be much more daring. We have a little bit of money for development. America, there's zero money for development. And we can really use this opportunity to reinvent ourselves, come up with some great stories, and take tremendous chances on risk with our filmmakers, and also in this genre, this particular genre of films for kids. And it is possible. And I know that if we want, we can really put a focus on original stories. And I think this is what we should do. And I'll give you a 1 minute pitch of somebody who came to me and pitched me a story, which ended up being a very successful feature film. So the guy comes to me and says, I have an idea. I want to make a film. I told him, what's your film? A young director, he said, listen, the story is about this young kid who's 12 years old, 13 years old. He lives with his mother, father, very warm family. Everything is okay in a nice house, this and that. One morning, a knock on the door, 7:30 in the morning, he's about to go to school. 3 policemen at the door. They came to pick up his father. Before he understands what's going on, the daily newspaper is thrown in, and then he sees the picture of his father on the front page of the newspaper, and it says his father is now being suspected for bribe and this and that to be being the deputy mayor of one of the cities. At that moment, the life of this seventh grade kid will change forever, because in half an hour from that moment, he has to be in school, everybody will point, the father, the big figure that he had about his father, admiration, what will it do to him? Immediately the imagination started working. I told him, go and make your film. And I asked him from where it came. Of course, it came from his own personal experience, as many of the stories. And it ended up being with a very successful, heartwarming, not an easy film about the personal experience of the filmmaker. And I've learned throughout the years that many of the most successful films, at least in our case, where I come from, are heavily based on the personal experiences of our filmmakers. And I think there is a lot of that. And I think that we have to do it. And I think that my really recommendation and crusade, and many people know it here, is really to wake up the producers, to wake up the European producers and also the producers in my country. You know that if you go to all the pitching platforms in Europe, table by table, desk by desk, you will see that hardly any project was initiated by a producer. Most of the producers are sitting in front of the grocery store waiting for the directors to come to them and say, will you produce for me my film? This is very nice. It's one way of doing it. But I think that the producers should really initiate, because it's not an easy life to be a producer. Why are you a producer? Don't you have something to say, something to tell, something to say and tell? You picked up a tough life. So the idea is, how do we bring the producers to really initiate? And when it comes to films for children, even more so. and they can be the prime movers, and they can be the ones who so-called hire a writer, and then really cast the right director for the film, etc., etc., but really push, and it's possible, because I see in Europe that there's no balance in it, and I think we should be much more balanced in it. You know, we have taken upon... I'll finish in 2 minutes. You know, we have taken upon our life, you know, not an easy life, and this life involves a tremendous amount of risks. I can tell you about me personally. Some people know that my roller coaster and so on. And you know, I had a teacher in NYU, and he was a terrible man. His name was Robert Altman, and he was a real fucking son of a bitch. And he was really trying to break our will to become filmmakers, and used to tell us to recite after him at the beginning of every lecture. And he used to say, listen, dumb heads, if you made up your mind to become filmmakers, you should know it's not a profession, it's not a job, it's not even a way of life. It is a slight mental disorder. If you'll understand it, you will survive. So I'm 48 years in this business, more or less I survived. And I will tell you, you know, we all have our ups and downs. And sometimes in these down moments, I always remember this tiny little story that many of you may know about this very, very poor man who had only 2 euros left in his pocket. And with 1 euro, he bought bread. And with the other euro, he bought a flower. And we are the ones who provide the flower, and it's a great privilege. Thank you very much.